Pinella?
Here.
Commissioner Hightower?
Here.
Commissioner Webb?
Here.
Commissioner Goss?
Here.
Mayor Butler?
Here. Minutes of the meeting, August the 10th, any addition or correction? Okay, if not, they will be approved. All right, I think we have with us this evening some young men. I believe they are Boy Scouts. Do you want to come up here, fellas? Tell us what you're about.
Hi, I'm Warner Ritz. I'm from Troop 7042 at Waterscape Church.
Troop 42. Okay.
Sorry, that's a mix-up. Connor Harnett, same troop, same church. Just transferred down here from Chicago.
How about that? Well, all right.
I'm Brandon Connor from Troop 42 out of Waterscape Church.
Okay.
I'm Ryan Kozanowski from Troop 42. I'm from Waterscape Church.
All right. I have a question. How many merit badges do you have?
Ryan, talking to you.
31.
31. Don't these other guys have merit badges? They're...
Well, come on up here, you guys, and tell them how many merit badges you have and how long you've been in Scouts.
I have 2 merit badges, and I've been in Scouts since I was in first grade.
He's been in Boy Scouts for like 6 months.
Boy Scouts for 6 months.
Oh, my. Now, your name is Will.
Yeah.
Will, okay. I think I know somebody sitting up here who may be acquainted with you.
Yep, my grandma.
Oh, so your grandmother is Alice Ricks, is that what you're saying?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. You better tread light.
Yep.
Okay, how many merit badges?
I also have 2 merit badges.
Oh, that's great. And the boy from Chicago?
22. I've been in scouting for 5 years.
Oh, that's fantastic. 22. Now, have you got your Eagles rank yet?
I'm currently working on it right now. I just have a 4 merit badge.
Oh, how many do you have to be an Eagle Scout?
13 required, and there's 8 additional.
Okay. Well, when I was going through the Scouts, 21 merit badges were necessary. Yep.
Well, they just raised the required ones by one, they added cooking.
Oh.
And, they added cooking and then just took one of the alternates away.
I wish they'd had that when I was going through my first overnight hike with the Scouts. Of course, going to have to cook breakfast. And so I decided the easiest thing to do would be to make pancakes.
I made so many burnt pancakes.
Mine weren't burned, they just turned out hard as rock. And so I could have used a little cooking experience. Okay, now what's the purpose that you're here for this evening?
We're working on our citizenship, a community merit badge. We want for our Mesa to attend a city council meeting.
Okay. Okay, communication, and the other was the government or community?
Citizen and community.
Yeah.
They have 3 citizen merit badges. Citizen and community, which deals with local, city government. Uh-huh. And then you got citizen in the nation, which is what it sounds like. And then you got citizen in the world.
Oh my. Does that mean citizenship in the world? Does that mean you get to travel, take a boat ride?
We wish. If you can afford it, they do it. But that involves is finding someone from another country to help. A lot of times we have merit badge counselors that are from other countries, and we go to a merit badge university like up in Evansville in February, and they usually get that there.
You mean you've got a merit badge university?
We have several we go to, yes.
Oh, why do you laugh, Harry?
I love when you ask the question.
October, I think it is, we're going to Carterville High School, and we'll have a bunch of merit badge counselors like myself there, and we'll do maybe 25 different merit badges, and based on, we call that merit badge university.
Oh, yeah,
and we'll spend Saturday there.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And then there's one up in Evansville in February, there's one in Murray, and then there's one at SEMO.
Oh, well, that's great. By golly.
There we go.
Okay. I'm sure you're interested to know who these people are sitting up here. This is Jim Webb. He's the police and fire commissioner. This is John Goss. We don't know what he does, but he's a street commissioner, cemetery commissioner. This is Anthony Brunella. He is the water man, also the finance commissioner. Angelo Hightower over here is public property, and he's in charge primarily of the sewer department. Left out somebody. Oh, me. I'm in charge of public affairs, and what that means is that I'm in charge of everything that nobody else is in charge of. So sometimes that gets to be very interesting. Well, all right, having said that, do you have a question, any of you fellas?
You guys have any future politicians out there? We can use your help in the country, don't we?
Yeah, they're working on it.
I understand there's a new mining merit badge. Have any kids been into the mining yet?
We had two of the older boys that did it.
Good.
It's kind of detailed.
Yeah.
And then they actually went down in the mine and earn it.
Good. Good deal.
And that'll be one that'll probably be at the Carterville Merit Badge University.
Boy, do you get to mine coal if you're working on that?
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's nationwide, so there's probably some in the hard rock mines out west, copper mines and stuff.
Yeah. But
in this area, it'd be mainly coal.
If I were working on that merit badge, I'd want to be on a strip mine. None of that underground mining for me.
Or being a gold mine.
Oh, he'd like to be in a gold mine. Which reminds me, a year ago, wife and I took a trip out west. We were going to Mount Rushmore to see the three presidents on the mountain. And part of the tour, they stopped and gave us a little lecture. There was a big hole in the ground. And it happened to be a gold mine. It had been in operation about 100 years. And they had mined 44 million ounces of gold. And then they showed us how they got it. They had big, big rock. And you could see specks of gold in that rock. And they would crush this big rock to get maybe an ounce or two of gold. A fantastic operation. And then I got to thinking, 44 million ounces of gold, and at that time, gold was selling for about $1,000 an ounce. Well, that was beyond me. I mean, gee whiz, I couldn't calculate how much that would amount to. So mining can be a very interesting thing, even if he would prefer to mine gold.
I have a man here from Marion. I know he's a mining engineer, and that's what he does, is gold mines up in Alaska. I just talked to him this weekend. He was back. He takes a couple months off every year. The Marion area, it's his kids area.
Yeah, well, that sounds very interesting. Okay, now, you're being from Chicago. How long did you say you've been here?
Well, I've lived here for 2 years, but I haven't been very active in scouting because of school. I've been focusing on my studies and
whatnot. Oh, that's great. Were you familiar with the Chicago city government while you were up there?
It was a while ago, so I guess I was younger, but.
Okay. Okay. Well, believe me, you've not missed anything. You're lucky you're here. Yeah. Okay. Well, we certainly appreciate you being here, and we hope that you will learn something a little bit. And anything that we can do, or any question that you might have, well, don't hesitate to ask.
Did you tell him you were an Eagle Scout?
No.
Well, you might mention
that. No. They
you
tell,
normally do.
That they can tell the listening crowd. I had been a scout. Okay. Latina, do you want to come up and tell us a little bit about what the government is doing to us?
The government, from the federal government all the way down to the state, we've been cut for the senior services, the meals on programs. We have a different budget fiscal year than they have. We have the contract with them. It runs from October 1st through September 30th of each year. We found out on Thursday that we were losing almost $20,000 of our budget. And according to our fiscal year that we have with the city, that runs from May 1st, April 30th, which will cause us to lose about close to $10,000 for this fiscal year for the city. Mayor has told us that we will do the best we can to take care of these. And I know he's run an ad in the paper that said today that they will subsidize us until further findings of what we could do. We did have TV3 with us today, and I shared with them that the subsidized from the city more would be there. And they asked me what would happen if that would not be the case. And I said, we just found out the news on Thursday, so we're not sure what our plans would be as of yet. So we had 97 for our meals today.
Wow. Of course, Latina is the director of the Senior Citizens Center. And that is one of the best nutrition programs going. And what would you say your average noon meal would be? How many people?
85. 85 is our daily average, yes.
And of course, you have a suggestion. Donation by those who are eating?
$3 is a suggested donation. Our average comes out on that about $2.52 is what it comes out monthly.
So
sometimes it'll vary, you know, a few cents.
Yeah.
Well, one of the important things, it goes beyond the meals.
Oh, yeah.
It allows seniors to go there and interact with each other and
social connections,
and do things they wouldn't do at home by themselves, so
exactly.
it's more of a benefit than just a meal.
Yes, it is.
Okay, that having been said, you would be about, $9,000-$10,000 short between now and
April 30th.
April 30th, our fiscal year.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Do you believe this $9,895 is an accurate figure? Or?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so way to get us there. Mayor, be my motion to supplement the senior citizens for $9,895.
I'll second that.
Got a second? Call the roll.
Commissioner Hightower, or Commissioner Brumella.
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Goss.
Yay.
Mayor Butler.
Yay. Thank you, Latina.
Thank you.
Sure thing. Okay. Anybody else have something we need to take up right now?
Jared does. The fire chief does.
Oh, I know. You're not telling me anything I don't know about those guys. I'm thinking about people like Harry here. You're just observing.
Democracy in action.
Yeah, there's Jim.
Jim. I'm going to be short with this. I'm not going
to. You better be, because we don't want to repeat what you said before.
No, I don't want to repeat anything. That's the whole point. I'm going to be short. If you had anything to do with the post being removed from Mom's driveway Friday, I sure appreciate it, because they were trying to keep her carport from her getting into her carport. She's
don't know what you're talking about, Jim, but go ahead.
Okay. The other thing is, you know, for months now, especially since March, in April, I've been trying to get the Marion City Council to help me expose trees in the United States. I don't know if the council's done anything or not, but this will probably be the last time I'll be here, because September 13th, the blood moon, is fast approaching, and I believe that the American economy is going to be collapsed by the international banking elite. And that's what I believe, and that's why I've been so passionate about trying to expose trees in the United States. Now, I have updated this. There it goes. But anyway, I've updated this, and I've passed it out to the Carbondale community and the City Hall Saturday, and it's in the hands of the Southern Illinoisan and Channel 3 and KBSI and all different radio stations and TCT and all over the place. I've distributed all throughout Marion. I've promised that I wouldn't do anything illegal, and I haven't. I've just been honest and open and tried to wake up the American people to this impending doom. And I've tried to be very prophetic about it. Now, the thing about it is, all I'm asking the council to do now, it wouldn't cost them but a stamp to send copies of this. There's six pages. There's 12 altogether, but two on each side. There's six actual pages to all the residents in Marion to help wake up the American people as to what's going to happen if we don't wake up and legally expose treason to the United States at a constitutional tribunal here in Williamson County at the Williamson County Courthouse. Now, this needs to be done so we can get a jubilee. If we do not expose treason to the United States, this is our year of jubilee. There will be no jubilee. I'm just telling you, in America, you have to do things legally. And what's going to happen when we do, our congressmen, our senators, and presidents will sign off the federal deficit with a stroke of a pen. And everybody's debts will be canceled. But if we don't do it, we're going to be in severe bondage, and millions of Americans are going to be killed. That's
okay.
It. That's all I got to say. And I'm asking you to help. That's
okay.
All I'm saying.
We thank you for your observation.
The other thing is, I'm just letting you know I've done my part, so it's not going to be on me.
Very good. Okay. Anyone else? All right. If not, what's the water department valve activator trailer and four truck? What's that about?
Sometime earlier in the summer, we took bids on a new machine to help us locate water lines and keep us from maybe cutting into fiber optic or gas lines or you know, sewer or water mains that are in old areas and not marked.
That's a valve activator?
Yeah, that's part of the truck. That's what it does. Actually, what this truck will also do, it has a system in it that will help us mark valves and everything else and water lines as we go along. William has been working with the guys and got them on, but we approved that and budgeted it, but then after we thought about it, we thought it would be better off to borrow that money with some of the low interest rates we're getting, and that's exactly what we decided to do is to...
Is this something like what Julie does?
Well, they just kind of go out there and get you an approximate location of where they are, and that's some of the reason that, you know, we've had issues. I showed you one last week where we got into a gas line of Ameren's, and you know, and then we got fined, and because
and where Julie said Doug digged 14 feet away.
Well, that was one day we come outside the Julie, we went beyond what they had done a couple feet and hit a line. Then the next day, thermocate was off 14 feet, and we hit the same line again. Well, you know, that's another issue.
Yeah,
this,
okay.
That's what this truck's for, is to prevent that. It uses water to expose those lines and everything so that the bucket of the truck doesn't. So that's what that part is. And then the truck for towing was another $23,000. Comes to $91,929 for 3 years. Midland Bank had the low bid of 1.99% with a closing fee of $50.
Okay, you had three other banks that submitted bids.
Yes. All higher, and two didn't have a closing fee, but they were significantly higher.
So it runs a little over $32,000 a year for 3 years.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's your motion?
That's my motion to accept the bid of Midland Bank.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Rinella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, loan agreement with the EPA for water main replacement.
You want to do the Morgan Avenue? Morgan Avenue first.
Oh, I circled that. Well, let's go ahead and get this, and then we'll go back to Morgan.
Glenn, you want to talk about this? Gibbs has been, he's been, this guy's jumped through more hoops than a circus dog to get this finally done.
You've been working on this close to a year. On the purpose that it was we have five locations in town where we're replacing undersized old leaking water mains. So we applied for the EPA, what we call the EPA revolving loan, which is a 20-year loan. And I believe it's 2.125% interest for 20 years. And we finally have all the paperwork, the documents, and the city needs to agree to do this. Yeah, the loan amount is $500,651, and the interest rate is 2.21% for 20 years. And the city, if they agree for the terms and conditions of this, they need to sign it, send it back, which will then enable a city to issue the notice to proceed to Scooter Construction Incorporated to commence work on the project.
About what's that going to figure a year?
On the debt service?
Yeah. $25,000?
How much?
About $25,000.
$25,000 plus?
That'd be $27,000.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yes.
Got a motion? Two of those mains in question broke last week and were repaired.
Yeah, good. That's your motion?
My motion to accept this.
I make a second.
Got a second. Call the roll.
Commissioner Rinella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Great. Okay, what about the Morgan Avenue state grant money? Where are we on that?
State, yes, I don't know that.
If you recall, when we did our last bond issue last December, we did it based upon, you know, we had borrowed money the last couple of years for the Hub Recreational Center.
Yeah.
And Morgan Avenue. Well, so you know, we're getting, or we've got a half of the $2.5 million of the grant back
on the rec.
On the rec. Okay. Right now, we don't have the other $1,250,000. We're not sure when, you know, we're going to get, with the mess in Springfield right now. Well, we had, you know, borrowed based upon that amount.
The promise of the state to
right,
come
exactly.
Through.
And I compute we probably owe another 1.4 to 1.5 million on Morgan. So we're going to have to dip into our committed funds in order to pay that. Okay, then hopefully then when the state money comes in, we'll reimburse the committed funds then.
Okay.
We won't have to dip in for the full amount because right now we have reserve that is in excess of what we're required to have by ordinance.
Yeah. Okay.
To the tune of about I think about $800,000. So roughly then we're going to have to dip in $600,000 to $700,000 into our committed funds.
Yeah. With the idea that that would be replaced.
Exactly right.
When the state comes through.
Exactly right.
And we've got our fingers crossed on the state coming
exactly,
through.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, if that doesn't materialize, we'll have to, you know, go to Plan B, whatever Plan B is.
We'll have to constitute Plan B.
Yeah,
but,
exactly.
Hope must spring eternal, so we do expect the state to fulfill its obligation.
Yes.
Okay, is that your motion?
Thank you.
I'll make that one.
I was just thinking of the
finance
end of it.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Okay. That's Jim's motion.
I'll second
it. You second. Call the roll.
Yay.
Mr. Hightower?
Yay.
Mr. Webb?
Yay.
Mr. Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay.
And
Do I assume that my street department is short this much money now? Is that, am I, how, explain this and all this and gibberish to me, please.
It means...
The Morgan Street, that's my baby, but am I going to pay for it, or how are we going to handle it?
Yeah, well, never fear.
Okay, I feel better about it.
Just have confidence.
All right.
My promise is as good as that of the state of Illinois.
All right, I'll sleep well tonight.
Okay, we'll table the next item. Ordinance on the water and sewer tap, the street cuts, we're revising the proposed. Okay.
Number five.
Do you have that, number five, Angelo?
I spoke with Brenda, he gave me the lowdown on this. This guy, he's been with the sewer department for roughly 17 years. He's filled in this particular role in the absence of the old lead sewer chief operator, so, and he has all the requisite requirements, certifications, licenses, et cetera. Comes highly recommended, so it'd be my motion to approve Dave Williams as the new inside lead sewer chief operator.
Second.
With pay scale set forth in the 2012-2015 laborers union contract effective today. Second.
Okay. All right, got a motion made, second, call the roll.
Commissioner Vanilla?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, two new fire trucks. Jim, you got that?
Yeah, we've got need to replace two fire trucks that are actually 33 years old, I think.
Yep.
So these will be the pumper trucks. And I think maybe first we need to actually maybe have Jerry come up and talk a little
okay,
about it.
Yeah, okay, let Jerry explain that.
Yeah, currently we got two of our older engines are 1982s, they're 33 years old actually. And we started looking back in actually November putting specs together and reaching out to some of the manufacturers to get pricing on them. You should have a sheet there explaining that the city was awarded the assisted firefighter grant this year. It was to replace one of the 33-year-old engines because the government actually is wanting these engines off the road due to the age of them, and also they have the open cabs in them, or the open jump seats in the rear. So they're wanting to get these engines off the road. So that was one of the criterias for the grant that we stipulated, was to get rid of one of those engines. This year we actually budgeted $500,000 just in case we didn't get the grant to replace one of the engines. We was awarded a grant. Our portion of it will be $361,900. We also received a Harrison Bruce grant for $75,650. So the grant total comes up to about $437,550. If we look at the $500 that we already had budgeted for this year, we went ahead and got pricing on some trucks, and it looks like for about another $121,000, we can purchase two trucks using the grant and using the money that we also had budgeted for this year. The next sheet actually shows the pricing on what the trucks will cost if we do a 100% prepay up front. If we borrow the money and pay for the engines up front, we get about a $28,000 discount right off the top of the cost of the trucks. By buying two engines, both these engines are identical. By buying two of them identical, we get about a $26,000 discount on the second engine. So if you take the cost of the trucks minus the grants, it looks like our loan value is going to be around $621,474. The only thing with the grant money is it is a federal grant. We can only get asked for 25% of that money up front. So if we do the 100% prepay up front, we'll only get $90,000 of it until 30 days prior to the trucks being delivered. And then we can request the other $271,000. So for about the first 9 months, the city's actually going to have to borrow more than the $621,000 to cover the first 9 months. And then once we get all the grant money, they will restructure the loan down to our loan value, will be about $621,000. We actually looked at two different manufacturers, an E1 truck and a Pierce truck, and the E1s came in about $43,000 less than what the Pierce trucks was. That's why we actually went with the E1s plus the current engines that we have now, they're all E1 engines. The we looked at, we just recently paid off the ladder truck, and what the payment was on the ladder truck and the interest rate that we was paying on it was around $5,700 a month. And obviously we don't know what the exact interest rate's going to be until we get that back from the banks, but it could be very comparable to what we was paying for the payment on the ladder truck.
And when do you expect to get the figure on that?
I think you said it for Friday.
Yeah, I requested the banks to have their bid information to me by this Friday.
Okay. We don't have any idea what that rate might come in at?
Not yet, no. I've asked them to do a term loan where we pay interest only up front for the full amount, and then once then we're ready to turn it over to a 10-year loan where we do monthly payments and keep that same interest rate. So we'll have to, you know, see.
Yeah.
And that's the one good thing about it too. We also then hopefully can lock in an interest rate, so we don't have to worry about what interest rates might be 9 months from now.
Yeah, that's good. Okay.
Because the build time on these trucks, they say 240 days, but they extend it out to 270 days, which is 9 months. But that's the build time on the trucks.
Yeah.
From the time you sign a contract. So.
All right. Having said that, Jim, is it your motion that we proceed with this?
I'll say
yes.
Second. Call the roll.
Mr. Manella?
Yay.
Mr. Hightower?
Yay.
Mr. Webb?
Yay.
Mr. Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Bender?
Yay.
I would like to thank Jerry for his hard work on, and Steve both, they've done a lot of work on this, and I had a chance to sit down with him, and I was quite impressed with their thoroughness and bargaining power too, and trying to get the best deal for the city. So I appreciate that. Jerry.
Well, the big thing is here is the grant that he got.
Oh,
they just don't hand out grants to cities like Marion. You know, you can go back and look and see what type of communities have been given these monies for trucks, and they're not Marion's.
No, and I think as one of the stipulations in the grant, you know, that we read into, one of them was if you will donate one of the old engines to a training facility and get it completely off the road. The government don't even want these trucks on the road. They want them to be used
just
for.
You mean we couldn't give it to Rosa Claire if we wanted to?
Now, the second one you could, but one of them we have to give to a training facility because that's how we wrote the grant.
So you're saying you're giving one of them away?
Well, I would say we could.
And that is an option.
People do not realize how financially strapped really small communities are. It was either Elizabethtown or Rosa Claire. Mayor came by one day and he says, we need some equipment for our street department. And I said, well, what have you got? He says, really, we don't have anything. Is there something you could give us? And I checked, and we had a pickup truck at the street department that didn't run. And I said, you can have that. He says, when can I get it? And I says, today. He says, let me go get something to tow it with, and we'll take it back. They had a mechanic that could make it run, they felt. But that just shows you how difficult it is for a lot of smaller communities. And of course, we've given police cars away.
You know, and that's something you may look at the other engine, be up to council, but, you know, it's still a good engine. I don't know legally what we'll get into since it is an open cab. It's something we have to check into. But I've had, even one of the salesmen was there today, and the value of those trucks is $4,000 or $5,000, what the value of the truck is. So it may be something that you do look at. So.
Somebody could.
Okay. And that's the thing, you know, whatever happens to that truck, it is a fully functional truck that just does not meet the standards anymore. Those guys down there think nothing of jumping in the cab of that truck and taking it to a fire because that's how functional that those engines still are after 32 years.
Yeah,
and it's not the idea that we'd give substandard equipment to someone.
Oh, no, they're very functional trucks, very good shape. It's just they're just still getting older.
Yes, sir.
Down to like a little community, Cypress, on down 37. They had I was working down there a few years ago, and they had a dumpster fire on the job site. And they showed up, and it was kind of humorous because it was a dumpster fire, wasn't no big deal. But that truck, we heard it for 20 minutes coming up that hill. And by the time we could see it, I could walk faster than that truck was going, and it had to be a late 1940s or early 50s truck.
And the pump probably
didn't work. And it had hose on it. I have garden hoses bigger than it had on.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you know very well then what we're talking about, which brings us, now, do any of you boys have any question you'd like to ask at this point? Have you learned anything? Oh, you have? Well, after the meeting, tell me so I'll know what we've done. Okay, did we vote on the, did we call the roll?
Yeah, on the approval of the trucks,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we've got a motion made and second call roll.
I think they call it.
We call it.
We call it? Okay.
Yeah. You're on table number 7?
Yeah. Okay, now. Okay, Jared, I guess it's your turn. This is Jared Harrison. He's the director of the city's pavilion. Okay, what do you got?
We want to do a little remodeling of our kitchen area. I was lucky.
How little?
Well, about $10,000 little. We got a dishwasher donated from the hub and a new larger coffee pot donated also from the hub that I would like to make room for. Part of the making room for is remodeling our less than ideal prep kitchen.
I wish I'd known you needed a dishwasher.
That coffee pot was a $2,000 coffee machine. Is that about right?
That is about right, yeah.
Yeah.
It's quite the machine.
The rec center.
They, correct. They didn't need it or the dishwasher.
Let me just, I just want to interject because the hub didn't, it was our architect, it had been spec'd for the hub. But unbeknownst to any of the hub people or the plans, it was not usable by the hub as in the kitchen because it didn't fit within the scheme of the kitchen design. So, and it was, they were unable to return it, so the city actually bought them. So they were sitting in the Marion Training Center, and Jared said, I could really use these. So that's how, when we say donated, it was utilized by city funds, but we could not use them in the, so they're brand new.
Yeah, very good. Okay, all right. Now, what do you want from us?
Say that again, I'm sorry.
What do you want from the council?
I want you to approve me spending this money that I budgeted for. It's in my budget.
No, all right.
Oh, you have two budgets.
And there's a bid from Ross Construction and a bid for Zeller Construction. And then if you remember last budget year, we did some renovations to the office space, our office space, that we hadn't budgeted for, but we had the money for. So I kept those expenses down, and I would like to do one more small renovation to our office and add a door to what is currently our conference room. And if we add that door to what is currently our conference room, it'll be a smaller meeting room that we can rent out. And I budgeted for that as well.
I see you got the plumbing work required to relocate 3 compartment sink, install dishwater and washer, and a new coffee maker. That's what we've just been talking about.
Correct, yes. The bid from Ross to do all of that is $7,190, and the bid for Zeller to do all of that is $9,829.
What's the 2,980 conference room?
That's the cutting in the door.
Okay.
In the conference room. That's a separate project.
So that would be in addition.
That would be in addition to the 7,190. Okay. 7,190 is what it costs for the kitchen, and then the 2,980.
What are you recommending? On which bid are you recommending? Yeah, one from Ross and Zeller.
The cheaper of the two.
Well,
the overall cheaper of the two.
Which one is it?
Well,
The cheaper of the two would be Ross.
Even adding the base bid proposal of $29.80.
The Zeller bid for the door is $28.34, so it's a little bit cheaper. For just the door. But the kitchen is $2,000 cheaper through Ross.
Yeah, okay, I see what he's doing. He's up the top, door installation is the first one for conference room, then if you add the $4,109, $2,242, and the $3,477, you come up to $98,29.95 for that project, and then the additional conference room is $28,34.77, so.
Couple thousand dollar difference.
Yes.
Well, now, are you including alternate number one on the Ross bid?
Yes.
You're including the 960.
That should be totaled on the sheets that you have.
This wall down here, add that on that. You know, I got three totals here. Should be four. There's two here, there's three, and there's four.
Right. But here you go. We're not talking about the rings, okay? We got to add that number to this number.
Wait a minute.
Well, that's why I say that's not all in there, so.
I can throw in a fire truck if it'll help.
Oh. Yeah, Ross is cheaper.
Ross is the cheapest.
You think so?
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Webb is the engineer, he explained it to me.
I wish he'd explain it to me.
Well, I can't repeat it, but he convinced me.
Because I figure if you got 17, 11, you got 1,000.
Can I come up there and point?
Let's try. If you add this first
alternate number one, you come up with $10,170.
Right.
Okay, then what you got over here on Zeller?
$98,29 plus, if you're adding them all together, plus $28,000. See, that's not in there.
$2,800.
Yeah.
What happened?
I didn't add those two together. So it's $12,600, so we're also cheaper by a couple of thousand.
Yeah. Oh, well.
Sure.
Okay. Need a motion to approve the Ross bid.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Manella.
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Goss.
Yay.
Mayor Butler.
Yay. Okay. Temporary joint easement with EDT Communications and assignment to Hamilton County Communications. You want to explain to us what this is all about?
About 6 weeks ago, I came down in the comments section and I talked a little bit about purchasing EDT's network. I'm Kevin Pyle. I'm general manager of Futiva, a Hamilton County telephone company. This says on here Hamilton County Communications, but it would actually be underneath Futiva LLC. Our plans is to take the network, purchasing from Jimmy with city approval, that is, and provide broadband services across that at reasonable prices that we talked about. And so we've got a list of folks who are signing up right now, who are ready for that service. So I humbly request your approval for this and would be willing to answer any questions you have.
Okay, so he assigns to you and then you would be subject to the same conditions, regulations that he has been under.
Yes, but I've also added to that some additional benefits to the city, to that original agreement, and which has been submitted to Mr. Green for his review.
Okay. Any questions?
Is this a similar service like MediaCom or something? I mean, is it faster or?
Yeah, it's right now we can do 100 meg services and actually we can do gig services as well. And our intention would be to help the city provide gig services to all of its residents and businesses. Yes.
I want to become a gigabyte city before our neighbors to the west. Is that possible?
We can work on that.
Okay.
They got a little bit of a head start because they got a grant, and we don't have a grant, but if we can get additional financing, yes, we can make that happen.
Is that part of that $44 million grant that Clearwave got to begin with?
No, I think that was a community grant from the state.
That was biggie for them.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, we have not gotten any grant.
On somebody else's dime, that's biggie.
Yes, exactly. This is on our dime, though.
This will be available citywide, or?
Eventually, yes. Right now, where Jimmy's network is at, we can provide services right now in the business district.
Okay.
My main backbone runs straight down to the middle of the city. They're purchasing all the backbone, all the infrastructure that I have intact. Everything that's in the ground in Williamson County, they are purchasing, which makes it to where you guys don't have to worry primarily about them boring, going back on concrete. They're buying one that's already in the ground.
Yeah.
My agreement was transport only. These guys are a service provider. For 2 years, I searched for a provider that would up the ante a little bit more after we were about the grant, see what that would happen with that, to bring the cost down to a relatively reasonable rate. They offer a lot more services than a lot of the people around here, which you guys will find out a little bit later, but it's going to be a really, really good thing for the city. Mm-hmm. My problem is I'm self-funded. I pay for every bit that's in the ground myself. You know, like he said, without grants on, it's kind of hard to do. These are bigger companies that can actually take it to the next level.
Sounds good. Steve, did you have any thought or question?
No, Mayor, other than that one word change I shared with you before the meeting started.
After 30 days.
Mm.
You said up to 30 days instead of 30 days.
Yeah, up to 30 days. Okay.
It'll be my motion to approve this agreement for a right-of-way agreement with fiber optic with Futiva.
I'll second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Ranella.
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Goss.
Yay.
Yay. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Okay, Steve, where are you?
Right here, sir.
Good evening, everyone. So a couple meetings back now, the city council and the mayor challenged me to look at the employees that we have at the hub in regards to so many part-time employees and full-time employees, and where would there maybe be some changes that could be more beneficial to the structure there. And we said that we would go back and kind of look at that. One of the areas that we came across there was in our housekeeping and maintenance areas there. We've got one full-time staff individual. It's the director over the maintenance and custodial staff there at the hub, Ryan Oakley. And then we had part-timers underneath him that were doing all of our cleaning there. We have a budgeted kind of number of six that we were going to use, so six part-time employees there. And working with that, we've had some difficulties here and there finding six qualified people that have come through and done that. And in looking at that, we feel in providing some additional structure, making sure that we have the cleanest facility for our almost 7,000 members, having two full-time maintenance custodial leaders, so that way taking care of all the times that the building is in operation would be more beneficial. And as you can see in some of those things, keep us in the exact same fiscal status that we are currently. So I would like to ask for the council to consider approving a new position of a full-time maintenance coordinator for the Hub Recreation Center.
At what salary?
It would be at $11 an hour.
40 hours?
40 hours a week, yes, sir.
Okay, what's your pleasure?
Make a motion to accept the position, $11 an hour with, I've lost it,
John Miller.
John Neville?
John Neville, yes, sir.
Yep. Is this in addition to?
No, hold it. We're just approving the position right now. Number
this
11.
Is just the position that we would. We are creating a new full-time position at the hub.
That's my motion. I make a motion to create the new full-time position.
Okay, is there a second?
And it just doesn't, this new restructure doesn't add anything further to the budget?
No, this will add nothing further to the budget. It will actually be the reduction of a part-timer at the end of the day there. So
was your concern.
And that was going to be the question there. And you should have that handout in front of you there.
Compare the results
where you can compare the results there. We're going to be budget neutral with adding on the full-time employee.
That's where I was coming from.
Yes, sir.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Now, tell us about John Neville.
John Neville was one of our finalists for the maintenance director position. Did not get selected for that position at that time, but however came on in a part-time capacity and has done a remarkable job there with tons of praise from not only members and guests, but from our staff team as well. And is the candidate that we would like to recommend to assume that new role of maintenance coordinator at that $11 an hour rate.
See the guy up in glasses, kind of longer hair, dark
yes.
hair. Excellent choice. I'll make that motion next.
I'll second it. Call the roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, what about the two part-time employees suggested?
I know it says two there, but I've got three on my list here that came out there. So we got three. I have three part-time employees, Judy Irving in childcare at $8.25 an hour, Jared King, lifeguard two at $9.50 an hour, and Paul Overmeyer, a personal trainer instructor at $30 an hour. These would all be part-time positions under 1,000 hours a year.
Are these new positions or are they simply people filling?
These would all be replacing other individuals
positions have already been in existence. Correct. These are simply people filling those.
These are people replacing those. That is correct.
Now, Overmeyer will be, that's $30 per class, right?
That's per hour.
Yeah.
And that would be in the personal training realm and instructing that way.
But he's got to teach the class.
Correct.
And he may only have.
He may only work 1 hour a week. If he doesn't have any clients, he will have 0 hours in that week. It's performance based. He's got to hustle for it.
Will he have enough enrolled to pay his salary?
Say that again.
Will he have enough enrolled in his class to pay for his salary?
He will have no class other than going out there. When individuals are inquiring about personal training, we will give him those leads and then he is to work them.
There's no charge for his services then.
Correct. He's got to teach them to get paid.
Okay, having said that, what's your pleasure?
Let me just cut in with that one.
I'll make that motion.
Real quick, before we go too far there, I want to just talk about page two of that document real quick there before you motion and go all the way through there. We have a couple other staff just in wanting to make sure that we're keeping everything. Instead of looking back as part of that challenge from the council and the mayor to make sure that we're getting the most bang for our buck there, we have some employees that in certain areas are unable to get up to that 19 hours a week. They're only working maybe 10 hours in their original department that we hired them for. But we'd like to cross-train some of them and have them work in some other opportunities in the building to get to that so we're not hiring more additional part-time staff to work 10 hours here or 5 hours there. So we have three staff. Preston Barton, who's currently a lifeguard, two at $9.50, would like to have him approved as well as a wellness attendant at $9 an hour. Stephanie Palmer is currently a wellness attendant at $9 an hour. I'd like to have her approved to work in sports and recreation at $8.50. And then Michaela Allred, Lisa Drury, and Megan Cantrell have been working as camp counselors. Would like to move them to the child care. This will also help on our financial reporting and making sure that their payroll falls into the right departments.
What's going to be a nightmare for us?
That's for Lana. It comes in. We already have certain employees that are at
but the still,
yeah.
When it falls in, will that be a nightmare for us?
Depends where I'd have to go back and look to see where they're being charged at and what departments and how we're breaking that out. We have a ton of various departments. But yeah, but that will be up to Lana to get it to us right. I mean we have other people right now who will be working more in one department, I believe.
Yes.
As it is. Yeah, I mean it's not gonna make life any easier, of course.
It just makes things more efficient there. I
mean, it would make it more efficient on our side rather than having to hire another part-time employee and bring in someone else and go through training. The cross-training is already there and we're getting, you know, a more dedicated person,
My point was going to be, why pay them two different hourly rates if they're already working there under one rate?
Those were the standard rates that were approved by the city council for those different
departments prior to me arriving.
So they're doing one job part-time to get $8.50 an hour, then they cross over to pick up more hours and they're paid $9 an hour.
Those are the different rates that were established prior to me arriving, yes, sir.
Oh, okay, I don't know if there's any way to get around that.
Yeah.
I'm sure you're wanting to keep it equal.
I certainly want to make sure that someone that's working in one department is getting paid what someone else that's hired in that department would be getting, and not more or less.
Could I ask you one more question about this personal trainer?
Absolutely.
If he has one request, he gets $30. If he gets 10 guys in there, he gets $30 an hour.
If it is a group personal training, so let's say that was a situation where he has 10 people coming in.
He has one.
He would get $30 for that hour. If he had a group personal training where he had 10 people coming in, he gets $30 for that hour.
No charge from the people that requested.
Nope.
So he gets $30 an hour.
He gets $30 an hour. That would be his rate.
But those are members, right?
Yes, they have to be members.
Yeah, they got
to
be members. So they're paying by the month anyway.
In other words, you couldn't walk in off the street and get the personal trainer.
I might let Johnny walk in off the street and get a personal trainer.
I could be one of those personal trainers.
Yeah. Oh, he could be. Yeah, okay.
It's $30 an hour, Johnny.
$30 an hour, I'll take it.
Okay. What's your pleasure?
It's my motion to approve the part-time staff and rate changes for the those on the page.
I'll second it.
You got a second? Call the roll.
Commissioner Vanilla.
Yay.
Commissioner
Honeychild.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Goss.
No.
Mayor
Butler.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Steve. All right. What's this about the correction of minutes?
That would be me.
Okay, tell us what's going on.
On the May 11th minutes, in the minutes itself, ordinance 359 to rezone property between North Russell and McCluskey Street read in the minutes that it was ordinance 3259 when in actuality it was 3258.
Okay, so this is to put the correct
number
on the ordinance.
Yes.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Vanilla.
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Goss.
Yay.
Mayor Butler.
Yay. Okay. 3273. Anyone know what this is about?
Glenn does.
Glenn has spent hours on this.
Yes.
This is Triple F annexation.
Which one? I guess Sherry Sterk.
Sherry Sterk, do you all have the drawing in front of you there?
Yeah.
About the annexing of the property?
Yeah.
Okay. That's the Gary McGee is buying 5 acres from the Greg and Sherry Sterk, the Triple F Farms. You have the drawing that shows me the 5 acres, that's the annexation. Yeah.
Where's that located?
They're annexing a portion of the 5 acres they purchased.
Right.
Here is the piece of the total acreage. Here. And he's going to be building his house over on the western part, and he's taking in 1.7 acres of the 5 acres that he's purchasing, which will include where his house and his garage is going to be.
So he's not bringing in.
He's not bringing in the total 5 acres. He's bringing in balance. Here's the total 5 here, and what he's bringing in is this piece right in there where his house is going to be.
Just west of town.
That's how many acres?
It's you know where Melmar Estates is.
Yes.
Okay. It's at the end. It's on Francis Drive, the north end of Francis Drive.
Okay.
That's where that is located at.
Okay. Now, how many acres is he bringing in?
1.7.
1.7.
I have a picture which will help show a little bit more on that. Okay. There it is right here. There's the end of Francis Drive. Tom Wolf's house is right here. Watson's house is here. He's buying 5 acres north of this area up here.
Okay.
And he's annexing 1.7 acres on the west side there.
So he gets gets water in the street.
Yeah, it gets water in the sewer too.
That's out of our spring garden, that area.
Yeah, it's right here.
It's on the west side.
You know where Melmore is? Tom Wolf. Francis Drive is here. Okay, the end of the street's here, Randolph owns here, Watson is here. Like 5 acres to the north of this. And he's, the city limits is right here. So he's annexing 1.7 acres in this corner right there.
And.
Now, the second part is that we're having a dedicated street, which we'll get into next. And that's the next part, that the street has been platted to the end.
Let's take one thing at a time. Okay.
It's my motion.
Ordinance 3273.
For the annexation.
3273.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Rennell.
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Goss.
Yay.
Mayor Dutton.
Yay. Okay, now get into Francis.
He's annexing the Francis Drive, which is on the north end there. It has presently been dedicated to the end of the.
To where?
Wanted that.
Annexation.
It's presently in, to the end of the Randolph property, which is right here, where that green line is. It's a dedicated street to there. Now, he's going to dedicate a 78-foot piece on to the north of that, which is that little piece right there, yes. Looking out on the
annex street right here.
Yeah.
And the annex property was here. That's the 78-foot strip he's annexing here, so that the street will go up to his dedicated street to his property line.
Yeah, okay.
Does he pay for the construction on that, or how's that?
I'm sorry?
Does he pay for the construction?
Yeah, what he's going to do, he's picking it up for the asphalt ends right here.
Okay.
Here. He's going to build a 12-foot wide strip to, which is either going to be concrete or an asphalt street up to this, to his property line here. And then he'll continue that on down to his garage, which is down here. Probably this falls off real steep as you go to the north. And he's got 5 acres. Probably nothing will ever happen, transpire in there, but right now the agreement was that he would build a 12-foot wide permanent street to his south property line.
So it'll become MF2 eligible then, I guess?
Yes.
Yeah.
Who made the agreement? Point fingers, somebody had to make the agreement.
I was part of the agreement that I didn't do the cost with that, but for he's paying us to extend the water main, the 6-inch water main for him.
All right,
and the tap and everything
what,
like that.
What
so.
I'm concerned about is you got a 50-foot right of way, and he's only paving 12 feet. Now, is he going to come back someday and say, this is a city street, why don't you complete it?
Part of the agreement.
Well, wait. Part of the agreement of what? That we finish the street?
No.
Whatever you want to make it.
Yeah.
Well,
how wide is the pavement now? He'll be matching
he's
up.
He's got 24, he's a 24-foot asphalt street there now that ends up about probably 80 feet short of his property line.
And he's going to put 12 feet wide from that point up to his house.
Up to his house.
On his own property.
To his own property, to the property line, and he will continue that on down to his garage.
I understand that he's going to extend that street, the existing street, like it was.
No.
To his property. That's
no, 12 feet wide is all he's going to do.
In essence, this is a private, in essence right now, it's a private drive from where that ends there on up to his house.
Well, then he doesn't have to dedicate it as a city street.
The seller who's selling it to him wants a 50-foot right-of-way in there for the...
It's my understanding, which obviously is not right, that the existing street was just to be extended as was, to the same type of... treatment that they
That's where the 12 feet
I know, I understand that's
in.
What it said, but that when we first
there's
talking.
There's nothing written in etched in concrete. It was signed an agreement, as I understand it right now. This is just a verbal
understanding. My understanding is they're going to continue the street as it was, the same type of composition that they agreed to. I didn't know they cut it to 12 feet.
I wasn't aware that there was any agreement that everything had to go on up to the, where it was at now.
Up to his.
Well, I'm only concerned about what has been dedicated as a city street.
The city has an option of not accepting the dedication.
Well, okay, but we accept the dedication, and he says he's going to build a 12-foot strip down the middle of it. Is that right?
No, he's going to build it on one side. It would be on one side of the center line or the other side of the center. Not that I don't know if it makes a lot of difference or not, but it would be a 6-inch concrete.
So you suggest we put a stipulation in there that the city has no further obligations
to improve or expand the surface of that street?
I would make another suggestion, Anthony.
Okay.
Let's carry this on one step further. A lot sold back here, and he's got 5 acres. Whether he ever sells the thing on it or not, I don't know. Nobody else knows. If it's extended, no permits will be issued until, other than this one house, and until somebody builds, until another resident builds on there, at that time, it would have to be by the developer extended for 12 to 24 foot wide.
What is the width of the existing road?
24.
See, I understand he's going to continue that right up to his
property.
But
he's not.
I understand why they said that, but when our conversation we had with him, that was down to what it was. I thought he'd draw.
You forget that conversation. Well, now it's 12 feet.
I'm not for that 12 feet.
On one side or the other.
Nothing has been signed.
I'm not for that 12 feet.
Nothing has been signed.
Glenn, do we have a minimum standard for accepting streets?
Yeah. Now, the minimum standard for accepting, this street was put in back when it was where we had the subdivision ordinance, and it was 24-foot wide with rural side ditches. Today, the ordinance says you have 27-foot wide curb, gutter, storm sewer, and inlets.
Okay.
Are you going to build 80 feet of curb, storm sewer, and inlets when everything else is a rural section?
No, yeah.
No.
He's kind of grandfathered there.
Yeah.
That's correct.
What they're going to do.
Won't do that.
No, I'm going to extend the existing street. I'm not getting that.
Yeah, but you can see where I'm coming from. He's dedicating, 24 feet wide?
No, he's dedicating. Gary and Sherry Sterick are dedicating the 50-foot right-of-way. McGee is the one that's going to be building the road.
Yeah. Well, okay, they're going to dedicate 50 feet, and he's going to put in a 12-foot wide street.
That's correct.
I just don't want the city to get hung for paving the rest of that.
Then don't accept the dedication of the street. It's a private road.
Could we accept the dedication but not take the maintenance? In other words, we'll not take the maintenance till it's built up to standard.
Whatever the council wants to do.
Because like you said,
I've seen that done
some little
times
widow
past.
Woman buys up there, you know the city's going to come up and take care of her.
Okay. Now, but if you have, I don't know how many houses. You could have one house. If an additional dwelling is built, no permit will be issued until the street is put to 24-foot wide city standards. Right now, it's a private drive to his house. Is what it is right now. And it may be that way for 50 years, and in 2 years from now,
it won't be private if we accept the dedication of that.
See, I thought that getting that street up there accepted like we were talked about was largely so that Sterick's could also build out there if they wanted to, because you had a street up there to it, and this eliminates that. They can't build on that with a 12-footer.
Well, they could.
Well, yeah, I guess, but not the way if we restrict it, they can.
Well, no.
So do they have property adjacent to that could be built on?
Who's that?
Craig and Sherry.
Yeah.
No, you have to go all the way to the back of McGee's property to get to theirs.
Yeah.
So the chances that ever happened would be pretty slim. Because here's what they sold to him. Here's the end of the road down here right now. Okay, he's going to make a permanent road up to here. All right. He owns everything shaded in the shaded area is his. So Greg and Sherry owns around back through here.
Right.
Okay. So he's got all of this.
Well, I got him landlocked.
What's that?
I have him landlocked?
No.
No, he's got him ready access.
He basically got them landlocked from the road down here.
But their idea was they could hook onto that road, according to what I remember Sherry talking
this,
about.
This 50-foot was reserved for a future roadway through here. This 50-foot was reserved for a future roadway over to here. Yeah. They never happened. But they didn't want to, Greg and Sherry didn't want to have, so they could get out from this property back here, they could come to that 50-foot and do that and go on out.
So what I'm concerned about is that they decide they're going to build over there and they'll put in a street here and we got a 12-foot wide street here, and they're going to expect us to fill out the other 12 feet. That's what I do not care for.
Well, I think Commissioner Webb has a solution.
Oh, yeah, we don't have to act on
that. No, I think he's got a solution.
Well, no, the only other concern I've got is no cul-de-sac there, but you're telling me there's a room for other streets coming in. I mean, normally at the end of the street, you want
in the direction. The chances of that happening, Jim, I would say the way this is set up is nearly slim and none.
Yeah.
But they just, as a factor of safety, they said, I want to. So they, Greg and Sherry has some property back here that they could come up to here.
Yeah. Right. That's my only thing I'm thinking of, if you got to go plow snow, where's the truck going to turn around? You know.
Well, you got to walk. Or you can drive all the way around if it's
we're not going to plow that.
There's no street there, though.
Yeah. Okay, I think what we need to do is table it and make some stipulations to it.
I mean, if they'll go 24 feet wide, problem solved, right?
That's right.
No problem.
That's what I thought they were going to do.
Okay.
Or if they're not willing to do that and we still want to pursue it, then possibly do what Glenn's saying. Have a stipulation where.
It's stipulation, as long as there's one house, that's the only guy that can get back there.
See, we got to deal with one or the other, either the guy that's buying or the people who are selling.
Well, if there's just to say that if it ever other it's used by anybody else except McGee, then it has to be a 24-foot street or no building permits are issued.
Yeah, you know, when McGee sells his house. Which
he sells
a lot of houses, and the new guy that buys it's going to expect the city to come in and take care of that street, and we don't have a street.
Well, we can make a stipulation that would run with
the
land.
One house, 12 foot, that's a lane of an interstate. That's plenty of room for if it's a permanent concrete or an asphalt street.
We'll have to maintain it.
You would be maintaining it toward the public road to his property line. Yeah.
Okay, I think we need to table that and have a little more discussion.
So how far off of Francis is it to his property line?
It would he'll have to build about 78 feet of a 12 or 24 foot permanent road surface to his south property line. And then he would have to continue that on from his property line on up to, but if he's got it's a dead end street for all practical purposes when it hits his property because it's all private property.
Well, then why would we not require him to do that first 78 feet and 24 feet wide?
That's me to death.
Let's see, that's something we negotiate with a guy.
That's what we agreed to down in your office, was that he's going to extend Francis up to his property line, and nothing we said about a 12-footer. Now, all of a sudden, we've got 12 feet instead of a street, and I'm not for doing that.
Well, we'll have to have another meeting. That's very simple. Okay.
I just did the water lines.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Thank you, Glenn.
Thanks, Glenn.
Right. Dedication right away. Launching Enterprises. Extension of poll. Who's got that?
We run on.
Poll drive.
Dedication of right of way by Lodging Enterprises of Marion.
Oh, that's over there by the behind Cracker Barrel over there towards the Best Western Motel over there next to 57. It should be a flat up there on that.
Oh, okay. I see that. Approval part of dedication of right of way. All right, now. That's an extension.
Oh,
God.
No, that's not it. There he is right there.
Okay. It's item 16.
I got you. Okay.
this is 57 right away right there. There's that one that goes up to the Best Restaurant Hotel right here. That piece right over somewhere along fell through the cracks and was never dedicated as a public street, and these people have been paying taxes on it. So they would like to make that a public street then.
Oh, okay. Is that hard surface?
That's hard surface. The road's in there.
Okay. All right. What's your pleasure? We're picking up a street that's already built.
Concrete street.
No, yeah. I move we accept the plan of dedication on that right away for Lodging Enterprises.
Okay, got a motion second?
Second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Burton?
Yay.
Okay. Proposed ordinance 3274. Western Marion Development Classification. Where is this? This is not Morningside, is it?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, I got a question for you. By accepting this annexation, I mean, he's still got to come back to the city to have it planted.
Oh, yeah, that only thing you're saying.
Oh, this is just raw land.
Water because,
source, yeah, that's raw.
Because that's just saying it's going to bring it in the city.
We have a situation with water out there that needs to be addressed, and additional flow of water needs to be brought out there.
Or are you talking about treated water or storm water?
No, it's treated.
Treated.
Yeah. Well, we've had complaints for years about, you know, people not having low pressure and everything like that. And, you know,
can't understand why they have low pressure there.
Well, that's Feenstra. He's all the time complaining. I think at some time what we got to do is we got the water out there. It's just a matter of time to get.
It must be some valve shut off somewhere or something. That doesn't make sense.
Sure, because they.
Yeah, but.
Well, okay.
I mean, still, I mean, he's going to have to bring water in from somewhere else than what's there. And it's.
Okay, what's your pleasure with respect to ordinance 3274?
For annexation.
For annexation.
I'd make it motion.
Got a motion.
Second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, Gail, can you tell us about the resolution?
This is an inducement agreement. We have a developer who would like to, who has a proposed project that if we amended Skyline TIF, it would add several acres to Skyline TIF. This is David Arnold, and he already has a lot in the Skyline TIF that is east of his present business, and this would be he would be able to add more business to the city if we increase the Skyline TIF. And currently the Skyline TIF is, the majority of the property is empty and vacant. It is currently, most of the property is with Ron Osmond. But this would be adding, amending Skyline TIF to add a few pieces of property that would be used for increasing a business.
How many acres are we talking about?
Right now we're talking about, for this person, this inducement agreement applies to 1 acre.
As
we talked, Mayor, the city's going to investigate adding, if we can add a few other acres to this amendment for other possible projects. But right now, since we have to have an inducement agreement to add this, so the person can start their project.
Okay. What's your pleasure with respect to resolution 2015-22?
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Romello?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, next, it has been recommended to the council by the Civic Center Board that Gemma Elsherbini be the high school student representative to the Marion Culture and Civic Center Board for the school year of 2015-2016.
I'll make a motion to approve her.
I'll second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Okay, you got anything, Anthony?
Yeah, I make a motion to pay the monthly bills as funds become available.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay.
Make a motion to pay the consent agenda.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay. Anything else?
That's it.
Okay, Angelo? Jim?
Nothing.
John?
I've got a couple of comments I'd like to make on our Honeysuckle Lane emergency project out there.
Yeah.
Honeysuckle Rolls, whatever. It's been completed, and I want to congratulate the Claire de Ziegler Engineering Firm for helping us. It was quite a job, and George Jones's contractor did a yeoman's job out there. It was very difficult, and I just appreciate the fact that they got it all completed under a very difficult situation. And I might add that the street department's stepped up and saved about $5,000 on this bid, being the kind people that we are.
That's good. It's about time you started saving money.
And then also...
So now you're only $795,000 in the hole.
You bring up unpleasant things. And also on the consent agenda here with Claire, on the charge you did on the Russell roundabout, that roundabout is working beautifully. We haven't had any accidents that I know of. And I congratulate them on the design there, Brian. You did a beautiful job on it. So I appreciate it.
I guess I got one other thing. I've been given notice that one of my employees at the water department, Justin Mays, will be leaving us September 18th. He was only with us a couple of years, but he was an outstanding worker and a smart young man. He's moving on to go to work for the Department of Corrections, which will allow him to finish his education. He's seeking a degree in accounting, so he's not here. So I was going to gouge Steve that he wants to come back one day and take Steve's job. So, but since Steve's not here, it won't work. So, but anyway, this young man was we had his father before him. Tony was a diligent worker and never said no to whatever task he was given, and we're going to miss him.
Good.
Okay, thank you. We'll need to go into executive session for a real estate discussion. Before we go to that, though, does anybody have anything else we need to take up? If not, we need a motion for an executive session.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Manella?
Yay.
Commissioner Hightower?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Goss?
Yay.
Mayor Butler?
Yay.
Are they going to continue this meeting until next Monday for the bids?
I guess we must.
We'll do that after we
come back. We'll continue this meeting to next Monday.
Yeah.
When we come out of executive session.
Yeah.